Hey, what's up, everyone? Tedric85 here, and today I'm going to begin my Book 1 Legend of Korra vlog, which I had promised about over a month ago, but yeah, it's finally here, and, like I said before whenever I previewed this vlog, that, I was going to rewatch these episodes and that, and give not only my analysis of them, but, maybe put in some stuff from the future books and that, so, to begin with, it was nice seeing the intro of this episode, which, by the way, I should say that chapters 1 and 2, which the second chapter, Leaf in the Wind, which I'll be covering in the next vlog video, obviously, but the first two episodes were part of the series premiere of this show, and it's also, this chapter right here, Welcome to Republic City, is the first one to have... is the only one to have the extended intro where we got to see the old gang and that, and I thought that was pretty cool in that, and, speaking of awesome, how about the way that Korra, we first get introduced to Korra? Of course, the White Lotus ends up going down to the Southern Water Tribe to look for the next Avatar, and of course they go to Tanrak and Senna's place, and, it's weird seeing how young they were back then and that, and see, it's really adorable seeing a little Korra in that, but, speaking of Korra, that has got to be one of the most awesome intros of any character I've seen in any show. Right off the bat, you get to see her bending water and fire and earth and that, and she just owns every single bit of bending that she does, and you can definitely tell that the White Lotus was amazed too, the way they looked at each other, like, whoa, this kid is actually good. And to keep in mind, Korra is 4 years old here, and you see how powerful she is with three of the four elements in that, and, of course you get to fast forwards to present time where she's around 18 or 19 years old, and she just, passed her firebending test, and, here not only do we get to see the White Lotus watch Korra in action, but we also get to see Katara, which, at this time, we thought that she was the only surviving member of the old gang, which we would find out later on that Toph is actually still alive in the swamp. We get to see her in Book 4, but during this time, we see that Katara was really impressed, saying how strong she was, and meanwhile, the White Lotus is like, well, she's got the physical bending aspects down, but not the spiritual side, and Korra argues that the spiritual side of her bending hasn't come to her yet, but that, under Tenzin's guidance, that she would be able to learn that, and, here she really wants to, for Tenzin to instruct her, because he's traveling down to the Southern Water Tribe to not only train her in that, but to see Katara in that, which, of course, is his mom in that. And, not only did we get to see Tenzin, but we also got to see the first look of his family, Iki, Jinora, and Milo, and we get to see Pema, who's pregnant with Rohan at the time. And I thought it was pretty funny, too, because Jinora, right off the bat, goes up to Katara, and she tells her how she's read up on the old tales that she had with Aang and that, and she's like, and she asks Katara about how Zuko found her mom, and I can remember the first time I watched this, and I'm like, yes, we finally get to find out what happened. And here Katara ends up telling the story, and here Iki ends up interrupting, and I'm like, ah. I'm like, no. But, anyway, if you really do want to find out what happened to Zuko's mom, all you need to do is read the Search comics. And you haven't read them, I strongly recommend them, because they are absolutely awesome. I think I might actually like the Search comics more than The Promise, and I thought The Promise was a fantastic series of comics. So, yeah, in case you're interested in that, just give them a read, but, going back to what I was talking about before, Korra gets to meet Tenzin in that, which she is under the understanding, as well as Katara, that Tenzin was going to stay down there in order to teach Korra airbending, but the thing is that Tenzin ends up informing everybody that he has to go back to Republic City because of his duties to make sure everything there is in order because of situations that have been happening down there, which Korra is understandably disappointed in that, and she tries to think of ways that she can tag along with Tenzin in that, but both Tenzin and the White Lotus end up telling her that it's not a good idea that for her not to go down because she's not strong enough in that, and Republic City can be a dangerous place, which Cora ends up getting upset by this, and she ends up not being real thrilled with everybody. So she ends up having this plan where she ends up escaping, which I thought was really awesome because Katara actually helps her out too, which I think deep down Katara knew what Cora was up to. Katara's, as a matter of fact, she ends up looking at Cora and she's like, "It's a nice night for an escape, huh?" And Cora ends up looking at her kind of weird, and then that's when Katara ends up telling her that it's time for the new generation to stand up and bring peace and that to the world. And here Cora ends up boarding the ship, and which ends up going to Republic City. And I gotta be honest with you, when I rewatched this episode and I saw Republic City, and I was like, whoa, you see Republic City in this episode compared to how you see it in the last episode of the series. It's like almost night and day. I'm like, it's nostalgic in a way, you know. It just, unless you really follow the show like I did, like a really hardcore fan, you're not going to realize how hard it hits you until you rewatch these episodes. But yeah, Cora gets to see just exactly how big the city is. And you see her struggling to adjust to life to Republic City, you know, because she doesn't have any money, she can't buy anything, so she has to resort to going to a Republic City park and fishing, which, by the way, is illegal. But she ends up talking to this one hobo there that asked her for one of the fish, and here she ends up having to get out of the park and that, and while she's going along the city and that, she notices the Triple Threat Triad picking on the shopkeeper and that, and she's like, you know what, I'm going to take care of these guys, and we get to see just how strong of a bending she was. She took out all three of them with no problem, and whenever she got that firebending guy and threw him in the shop, I was like, whoa, that was awesome. And I was like, blown away. I remember the first time I watched, I was blown away. I'm like, geez, this is one awesome avatar we're going to see, and needless to say, throughout the series, she proved to be how awesome of a avatar she is. But yeah, as good as what her intentions were to stop the Triple Threat Triad, the Republic City Police Force, which is composed of metal benders and that, not only arrest the Triple Threat Triad, but arrest her too, which, despite her valiant efforts to evade them, she ends up being apprehended. And we get to see her being interrogated at the Republic City Police Headquarters, which I should also add, speaking of Toph, you get to see this big statue on top of the headquarters, which I never stopped getting amazed seeing that, because you could see the gang not only show their legacy and that from what they've done in their lives, but get to see a statue of Toph. Not only did you get to see a statue of Toph, but one moment that did hit me on the rewatch, which I can't believe I forgot to mention this, was whenever Cora first gets out of the ship and she sees Republic City Bridge and that, and she gets to look at the city of, she gets to look at the statue of Aang, and she just looks at the statue with amazement. I'm like, wow. I'm like, that is a really, I guess, poignant, which would be a more appropriate word than not. It was just a really good moment. She looks at that statue and says, like, wow, that was my past life, you know. He did so many incredible things, and now it's my turn to try to make my own path as the Avatar. And but yeah, that moment really hit me. But going back to what I was saying before, she ends up getting interrogated by Chief Beifong, which, of course, is Lin Beifong, Toph's daughter. And Cora tries to reason with her, saying that her past life and her mom were best friends and that, and of course Lin wants nothing of it, and she even goes to proceeds to tell Cora that, you know, your avatar status may impress some people but not me. So right away you get to see some friction between the two of them, you know. And of course I can't really blame Lin totally, because she is trying to do her job, and then despite Cora's best intentions, it's a bit of a learning curve for Cora's. She finds out later on in the series just how much of a learning curve it is, just adjusting to life in Republic City. But here, Tenzin ends up coming and getting Cora out of custody, and that making a deal with Lin, saying that he's going to take responsibility for Korra's actions and pay for all the damages and that, and which Lin reluctantly agrees to, but even Korra tries to reason with Tenzin to try to stay in Republic City, but Tenzin's like, you know, you're going back to a Southern Water Tribe and that, and here we get to see Korra getting ready to board the ship back to Southern Water Tribe, and here you get to see the airbending kids and that's wondering where she's going, and of course Korra breaks the bad news to them, but before she was able to go any further, Tenzin stops her, and he tells her that he thought a lot about what she said in that, and he ends up saying, you know what, Aang made Republic City, created Republic City as part of his legacy, and then looking at you, I come to realize that you are his legacy. So he agrees to have Korra stay with him and his family at Air Temple Island, and that way she could learn airbending. Much to Korra's delight, and you get to see her make this big hug towards Tenzin and her kids, and you can see how happy she is. I even remember the first time I watched this episode. I looked at Korra, I'm like, you know what, this is an avatar that I can see myself getting attached to. Sure, she has her naivety and stuff, and you know, she's a bit hot-tempered and she's a bit anxious to get into the action and that, but, whenever I watch this episode, even rewatch it, I'm like, gosh, she's so freaking awesome. and we get to see at the end of the episode and that, we get to see Amon and his lieutenant and that, where Amon says he has to speed up his plans, which you get to find out later on in the book, but, we get to see, even before that, we saw Korra see this anti-bending rally, if I can speak English, but we get to see her going up to this guy, he's had the megaphone in there, and he's saying how much the benders are oppressing the non-benders and that, and here Korra tries to talk to him and that, and of course, he ends up saying, you know, it's because of you benders and that's oppressing everybody and that, and using our powers to make us belittle us and that. And here she ends up going, you know what, I'm not oppressing anybody, you're oppressing yourselves. And he's like, that didn't make sense. But I thought that was pretty cool and that. But overall, even on a rewatch, I really like the groundwork that this episode provided, as it set the tone pretty much for the rest of the book and that, and so, but yeah, I'm looking forward to doing some more rewatching on this book, and of course, not only am I going to rewatch this book, but I'm going to do book two as well and that, and even watching this one chapter alone, I know I sound like a broken record, but the feeling of nostalgia I get when I watch this is just, it gets to me after a while, because you see how things are here as opposed to how things end up going later on in the series. It's just mind-bending just how much the world has changed in that time. But yeah, that's pretty much it I have to say for this episode and that. But yeah, I know this vlog entry right here is a bit of a mess. I haven't done one of these since the book 4 finale, but yeah, I hope this, you guys, whoever is listening to this, really enjoyed it and that, and here I'll have the book, I'll have the chapter 2 vlog entry, hopefully, later on today or sometime tomorrow and that, hopefully it won't be too long, and I do apologize for the length of time, I know I promised this a month ago, but I'm really looking forward to continuing this, and I really hope that you guys continuing to listen to this vlog, and I know I'm going to enjoy this as much as I enjoyed doing the books 3 and 4 vlogs and that, so, but yeah, thank you for listening to this, and I will see you again next time.